You are tuned to the frequency 9875 kHz. This program is beamed to Australia and New Zealand with a power of 100 kHz. By shortwave service 2017. If you want to write to us, please feel free. info@shortwaveservice.com. Once more, info@shortwaveservice.com.
Oh,
broadcasting station Sikulai,
which is, I should say, at the moment located near the second biggest city of Lithuania, Kaunas. At the moment, because the well-known shortwave transmitter is already shut down and the still operating medium wave transmitter will be relocated to another place in the country soon. It's quite sure that afterwards the whole facility will be dismantled. Let's go back a bit more than 90 years into history. Edita Šilionis is the expert in the heritage of broadcasting in Lithuania, and on my trip through the country I was able to talk to him.
In Lithuania it started in 1926 with the launch of the first broadcast station. That was in Kaunas, because Kaunas was then the capital. 1926, so on June 12, 1926, the first program went on.
That was a state broadcast, I think, and it did broadcast in the Lithuanian language for the people here.
Right, that was a state broadcaster, and it was also a military broadcaster. The transmitting part was military, and the editorial part was civil. So it was in Lithuanian language primarily,
because they
almost immediately launched also other languages for foreign listeners, because that was a long wave station, even long wave could travel. And they immediately launched also announcements in English and German, and there were short features in Polish and Esperanto.
At that time, Lithuania was independent, but 15 years later, history changed everything.
Yes, in 1940, Russia, which was called then the Soviet Union, occupied Lithuania together with neighbors Latvia and Estonia. And at that time, became the means of propaganda. There were also broadcasts that were not propaganda broadcasts, but the main thing was to Sovietize Lithuanian people so that they were Soviet foreigners.
Despite the programs of Radio Moscow, Peace and Progress, Lithuania had also a known foreign service. I think this is something special where
ties to Moscow. Partially, yes. We're not speaking about 1960s. 60s, 70s and 80s. So at that time, even other so-called republics, the main administrative divisions of the Soviet Union, were allowed to have foreign services. So almost all of them had foreign services, including Lithuanian radio. What was special about Lithuanian radio is that they started English foreign service without permission from Moscow. And they soon organized, did the paperwork, and everything was okay.
Why English? Is there a big community outside, or was the intention to inform English-speaking countries about Lithuania?
Both, I would say. There is a huge community of Lithuanians in the United States, in Britain, also in Australia. Not so big, but there is also communities in Australia, and many communities, small communities in non-English speaking countries, like countries of Latin America, France, Italy. So the primary task was to inform the Lithuanian communities, Lithuanian descendants of those Lithuanians who immigrated, actually they were refugees of the Second World War, from Lithuania into Western countries and settled in Britain, Germany, America. And the primary task was to inform children who did not speak Lithuanian. But the secondary task was also to inform the whole world about Lithuania.
Then the end of the 1980s came, your independence again on the topic list, and it finally got independent. And then there was something like, especially in frequencies, what belongs to the Soviets, what belongs
also involved in this progress, signing the divorce certificate.
Yes, at that time I worked at the Ministry of Information and Communications. And at that time Russian government was not so aggressive as today. And they were talking to us, and we could, in peaceful negotiations, so to say, we could come to an agreement. Which frequencies are administered by Lithuania, which frequencies are administered by Russia. And the conclusion was that the frequencies which are declared in the ITU as being originating from Lithuanian territory were administered by Lithuania.
There was one frequency left that made a big dispute
until the mid 2000s, the 1386
kilohertz. You are now working as an engineer on
Red International, and this is your frequency, and the Russians,
this is our frequency. What was happening there?
Right, the dispute came because of the situation when Russians, being obsessed with secrecy, they did not report to the ITU the right frequencies. And so the frequency 1386 was reported as being broadcast, as being used by Lithuania, as originating from Lithuanian territory in Kaunas. But actually the transmitter was operating from Russian territory near Kaliningrad. And that was a big station near Kaliningrad.
That was a more than 1 megawatt station,
and they could not give up this frequency without stopping their broadcasting.
It was a painful situation for them,
and it was several years of
disputes and compromises.
The compromise was so that they
give the frequency by hours.
Hours they
do not broadcast, then after some time they don't use the frequency for longer, and so on, until they freed the frequency totally. And then the frequency came to the Russian Mobile Administration.
But what you say, could that be that it took so long that it was because of the programming Radio Baltic Wave International was doing,
or is doing now, because it's not the thing that the Russian administration has to hear, I think.
At that time we were also broadcasting Voice of Russia, so it wasn't very content-wise situation. But I think it was more because Russians saw and see now themselves as a big, huge nation which has something to say in the world. And Lithuania, according to them, was a very little nation. So to give something huge from a huge nation to a small nation,
this is not something that a huge nation would like. This is a
question of honor.
I think so.
We will hear more from Sikita Sulianis later in the program when we will talk about the Sitkunai radio station in detail. One program from Lithuania we already mentioned in the talk was Radio Vilnius, the foreign service which also broadcasted in English language. I have met with Audrius Matonis, who worked there in the 1980s and beginning 1990s. He's our next guest in about 3 minutes. In the meantime, you can enjoy some tunes from Lithuania. Station that can be found on many, many old radio scales. They are named mostly as Kaunas. And when you tuned into the Kaunas transmission, let's say a bit more than 10 years ago, it was likely you received the English service of Radio Vilnius. Audrius Matonis was working there during the independence move and 80s, when Lithuania didn't want to be a part of the Soviet Union anymore. He is now, today, the head of news of the Lithuanian television, and I was able to meet him in his office.
As a news
boss, you know, perhaps people who say the public media is fake media, that you are broadcasting lies. It's also in Germany where somebody says Chancellor Merkel calls every morning the radio and TV stations to say what to broadcast. You started in Radio Vilnius when it was really a state-driven company. What was working as a journalist in the late Soviet times here in Lithuania?
I'm pretty lucky that I had to work under those strict Soviet control conditions only for, let's say, 2 or 3 years, because I came here in 1986 as a student of journalism, and the program I was assigned was called Lithuania A to Z. That meant that I had to travel through Lithuania and to make stories about the history of little villages, towns, about ethnography, about folk music in those regions, and so on and so forth. So I luckily avoided being a propaganda tool here. But starting with 88 and especially 89, 90s, then the movement for the sovereignty of Lithuania inside the USSR and then for the full independence, then those movements started, the major transformation started in Radio Vilnius. And the Soviet control and the Soviet censorship showed the signs of weakness. So all that censorship wasn't even able to control every media, including us. And we simultaneously started to care less and less about those representatives of the Soviet censorship in this institution, because until the independence was declared, we in this broadcast did have a special guy whose duties were to overlook everything that was going to be broadcasted. Nothing was broadcasted live. Everything had to be written on the paper and then recorded. So since we had a story in written form, we had to deliver it to the censor guy, and then he said that this is okay, this is not okay. We had the ability to record it and then to broadcast it. So step by step, simultaneously with all the independence moves, we started to ignore more and more those censor guys. And again, the first time we ignore them and they have no instruments to push on us, so we started to ignore them absolutely. We at first we even tried to find the excuses. We said, you know, things are happening very swiftly. Our program has to be broadcasted at midnight, and we cannot prepare it until 6 p.m. or 7 p.m. or 8 p.m. So if you, poor guy, want to stay here at work until the midnight, good luck with you. And on the other hand, they tried to sit here and to call us and said, look guys, we are waiting for your prints. And we said, nope. Unfortunately, they are not ready. You want to interrupt the program? The prince will be ready 5 minutes until the program will be broadcasted. Will you be so brave to take the responsibility on you to interrupt the program? You said, no, of course not. So shut up. After everybody understood that we don't need them and we hate them, and such a thing should be excluded from the practice of broadcasting, they just went on their pensions and nobody remembered them.
But there was this said 13th of January 1991, where Moscow sent troops to the country to suppress your freedom. 14 people died, more than 1,000 were injured. This was also a part in the history. People died, as far as I know, while protecting the radio station. How do you remember this day?
I remember this very, very, very exactly. And all those images and all those sounds are still alive in my mind. When I cannot recollect well without strong emotional feeling and embarrassment.
time when I have to speak about this, something happens to me. I think that we've experienced a very strong emotional trauma those days. Not of being afraid, not of being afraid that you'll be beaten or shot and so on and so forth. This was a very bad feeling of understanding that you can do nothing but stand that brutal military force. And again, as I've said, our program was being broadcast. We broadcasted at midnight, and during all those days, our team was staying in this building until the program was prepared and until it was being broadcasted. That was usually meant at until 1 p.m., let's say. So we were here when we got the first messages that the troops had started to move to the TV tower, which is several kilometers from here. The TV broadcasting tower is not in this place. So me and several of my colleagues, we rushed into the street. Just we wanted to documentize all those Russian troops moving into the TV tower. But at the same moment, we went outside this building. We saw that the second half of the troops, they were right here near this building, and they started to shoot here. We were shooting over the heads of the people. One of our female editors was beside me. She started to scream, and I said to her, "Oh, calm down, calm down. Spear shoots, it's just to make us frightened." And at the same moment, I've seen the marks on the walls of the building being made by the bullets. So I did understand myself that they are not shooting the spear shots, but these are the real bullets and these are the real shots, and they were exploding all those grenades. They weren't the grenades meant to kill. They were grenades to make people frightened and to blind them. You know, big splash of light and big sound. So we went home from there because the building was absolutely occupied. All our stuff was thrown back. It was packed with the Russian military. It was surrounded by the Russian military, and so we went home thinking what should we do tomorrow, because all our equipment was left in the building. All the possibilities to prepare programs were only in that building. Just again, remember, especially the younger audience, no internet, no mobile phones, no live broadcasting from your iPhone, nothing. So next day we again gathered together near this occupied building. But I should say that we organized pretty well. I mean, not only the journalists, I mean, first of all our... It didn't take long, I guess less than a week, when we had the studios being erected and prepared for the programming. Not in this building, but guess where? In the library of the blind people. Because here we have, of course, as anywhere else in the normal democratic world, we have the society of the blind people. They have their library, and they had the facilities to record the books for the blind people. Luckily, those studios for the recording books for the blind people were installed by the technical staff of Lithuanian Radio and Television. This was the same equipment. So it took really nothing to adapt them for the radio program. We had several rooms there, and we had studios there. And so we continued to prepare our programs. Those programs were being broadcasted from the reserve station in Sitkune. And one of the most funny things which illustrates the stupidity of the Soviet system and the stupidity of the falling regime was that the message
for the shortwave broadcasting was being delivered via relay lines to the transmitters in the far east of the Soviet Union, of Russia, and then the signal and the program was being broadcasted from the transmitters being installed in Russia, in Soviet Union. They had no idea what they were broadcasting, and they were broadcasting the messages about the cruelties of Soviet military, about their killings, about everything nasty and harmful what we were doing in Lithuania. So this, for me, this is one of the most impressive facts which illustrates
of the Moscow invasion in 1991.
The hood of bullets that were shot are still visible in the wall of the Lithuanian radio building. There are monuments at the TV tower buildings remembering those fighting people who lost their life during this very sad day in January 1991. But even this invasion didn't stop the collapse of the Soviet Union. And also some interesting things happened in the radio history that time.
There was one person who managed to start a commercial private landscape radio station. The first one not only in Lithuania, but only the one and only in the whole Soviet Union.
We'll talk with him in 3 minutes after some music.
Successful. Radio M1 was the only private radio station in the Soviet Union that existed ever. Here is the story.
In May and June of 1989, I with my family, we had a private visit in the United States. At that time, we already were allowed to leave Soviet Union and to go to private visits to Western Europe or to America. So we were in Massachusetts, in Worcester, Massachusetts, in the United States, and of course, naturally, I listened to the local FM radio stations, a lot of them, and that was a huge, a very big difference in content, in music, compared to foreign Soviet Lithuanian radio. So that impression was very strong, and I thought that maybe it would be a good idea to try to build such station in Lithuania. And then when I came back from the United States in July of 1989, I began this project together with some of my other colleagues.
But it was really legal, it was not a private station.
It was legal, and this first radio station was called M1. M means is for music, one is like first action. Well, we thought maybe we need a different name, let's say M24, because our deal was to broadcast 24 hours a day, but at the beginning that was not possible, so we started from 6 hours a day. So the first program was transmitted on December 31st of 1989. So we started at 7 p.m. and finished at 1 a.m. Actually, the first night was longer, maybe 2, 4 or 5 in the morning. And for this broadcast, we used the OIRT, so-called solid FM band. The frequency was 71.34 megahertz. The transmitting power was 4 kilowatts. And actually, it was a sound transmitter of the television transmitter in the Vilnius TV tower.
How was it possible to convince the authorities to do such an exploration?
Actually, from 1988 in 1989, some local liberation movement scientists was already and strong. And the local authorities, Komsomol and others, they understood that they need some changes. And therefore, well, of course, we needed the frequency, we needed the legal permission, we needed the cable to send signal from our studio in the Vilnius 18-story press building to the TV tower. So we needed all these permissions, and we got these permissions because the authorities understood that it would be better to make these permissions to these young people who want to broadcast a musical radio program.
You need not only a cable to the transmitter, but microphone, record player, tape machines. I think these are devices that couldn't be bought at the next local radio shop. How was it possible to build a studio at that time?
By the way, we got a very serious from West Germany. I think in September of 1989, together with my colleague Hubertus Grushnys, we went to Stuttgart, and there still works the journalist Michael Matik Gerlach. At that time he worked in the Süddeutsche Rundfunk, and he arranged some sponsoring or help for us, and the main sponsors were the Ritter Sport
chocolate company
and the local department of the Social Democrat Party of Germany. So totally they collected maybe 20,000 or 30,000Deutschmarks, and for this money we were able to buy I think Soundcraft, I don't remember exactly now, a mixing console, Vinyl record players, Revox open reel tape machine, I think Sennheiser microphones, some CDs, connection wires and so on. So this radio station, M1, was established with the help of our friends in Germany.
But radio needs also content. How about the music? I remember there was the Soviet record company Melodia who made some records, but that wasn't, I think, the hits you as young people had in mind to play.
Well, in 1989, it was already possible to find on the unofficial, in the black market, many CDs. So at that time we played music only from CDs, and we played jingles and call signs from open reel tape. But the music was already available on the market, different kinds of music. So we played rock music, we played pop music, but we had some special programs of folk music. At the beginning, initially, the musical program was quite consisted of many different genres of music.
What was the reaction after the first days when there was this new radio station, what was totally uncommon here?
Yes, the reaction was absolutely big, huge and positive. Many young people who at that time were 10 years old or 15 years old or 20 years old, they listened every evening from 7 p.m. till 1 a.m. to the studio to our studio. They were writing letters. They were asking to play this and this and this music. And that was a big, really big phenomenon in Lithuania. I would like to say that M1 was the first private commercial radio station, not only in Lithuania, but also in all Baltic states, in all former Soviet Union, and even in East Europe. There was some like semi-private broadcaster in Hungary, which was based on the state radio. So actually we can say that M1 was the first private radio station in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union.
And it still exists in its form and it's still in private hands. Not a press company or something else.
It is a private station.
It still exists. They transmit several programs. I think that until now it is the most successful
private commercial radio broadcaster in Lithuania. Now they use several networks. Each of these networks consists of maybe 20 or 30 transmitters.
That was a success story.
Rimantas Plekis, about the one and only private radio station
that existed in the Soviet Union, Radio M1, and is still audible today in Lithuania.
In a couple of minutes, we will talk about the transmission sites this program is all about today. Sitkunai.
Starting 1937, maybe, the idea came even in 1936, because this
engine in Klaipeda, or in German Memel, was launched
in 1936, and then came the issue about how to share the powers, and that the station was more powerful in Klaipeda than so we need a more powerful station and telling us where to build this powerful station.
Starting 1936 there was discussion. Starting 1938 there were concrete works.
Starting 1938 they also built a small shortwave station in Kaunas itself, in addition to the longwave station. And in parallel to that, they built a new station in Sitkunai. The building was ready, the power station was ready, and the transmitter was decided to ship from Great Britain to
Lithuania.
But then came 1940 and Britain involvement in the World War II, and the
British government refused to supply the transmitter.
Instead, it installed a transmitter in Britain for broadcasting of their own programming for other countries.
But Sitkunai is now broadcasting, so after World War II there is something happening that made the station alive.
Yes, after World War II the Soviet army dismantled some transmitters in Germany and brought it to Sitkunai and installed them there. Also, there was a medium wave transmitter installed in Sitkunai, which was used for broadcasting of Lithuanian national radio, not national, at that time it was not national radio, it was local programming in Lithuania, so to say. And the shortwave transmitters, there were two shortwave transmitters brought from Germany, they were broadcasting Moscow radio programs on shortwave. That started in 1950.
And then the huge upgrade came, I think, in the 60s, where Sitkunai got a high-power transmitter.
In 1965,
there was installation of a 150 kilowatt transmitter, and in 1975 installation of a 500 kilowatt medium wave transmitter. So the upgrade came gradually.
Now it's unfortunately a downgrade. When I visited the site, most of the transmitters and the history is already gone. It's a beautiful building. The storm transmitter is the last man standing, so to say, and the history fades away. What is your personal feeling? You were connected to the station and to the history for a long time. How do you feel knowing that it will be over in a certain way?
Well, of course, the feeling is sad. I'm sad. I don't know. I'm not a person of feelings. I am sad.
I am sorry that the station is closing down.
On the other hand, well, something happens. Now, speaking generally, something is born and something dies after some time after it's born. So this is a law of nature.
People can change it,
but people can shift it by time, but people can't change it as a whole.
But the Kuna still transmits on medium wave for a couple of weeks from now, and I was lucky to be one of the probably last visitors at the station end of March and see everything working. The impression of that you'll get after the next music. Impressive and sad at the same time visiting the Sitkunai radio station.
Omari Mankas and I came by car. The big iron gate was already open.
To the right, an abandoned guard post. Nobody was checking documents like in former times when armed forces protected the station. The road goes straight to the building. Trees line the road, like a little park. At the end of the road, an empty pond remembers one of the good old times when it was used for water cooling the transmitters. It's quite empty and silent in the hall. The shortwave transmitter is already switched off forever. The medium-wave transmitter is in standby for its next transmission later today. It will carry the program of Radio Baltic Waves International.
So we are here on our tour through Sitkunai in front of a very old Soviet workhorse. It's a transmitter called Torn. It's operating on 386 kilohertz, and yeah, it's hard to say, but it's the last man standing because the last transmitter here in operation. And transmits the program of Radio Baltic Waves International. Rimantas Plaikis with me here on the transmission side. How does it feel for you being at such a place with all the history and seeing this is the last thing working?
Yeah, so the old transmitter, Sturm S, was produced in Leningrad in the Soviet Union in 1965, and it is still in operation, and it will continue broadcasting, I think, until mid-April or beginning of May.
Well, yes, of course, it is said to be in the radio station, which will be closed down forever after 1 month from now.
But we are not very sad because the medium wave broadcasting on 1386 kilohertz will continue from new sites with a new modern solid state transmitter made in Canada. It is a Nautel NX200 unit, which will operate not at full power but only 75 kilowatts with omnidirectional antenna, and it is located in other place also northeast Lithuania. So we continue to broadcast, and we feel that this mission to send uncensored information to Russia and to Belarus, this mission is important. I remember times when I started to listen to short waves in 1972, when I was maybe 13 or 14 years old. And at that time, the Western broadcasting, such stations as Radio Liberty or BBC, Deutsche Welle, Radio Canada, Radio France or RTF or other stations,
were the only possible sources of free information.
So as I like to say that there were no political prisoners in my family, but I got all my right ideology from Western broadcasting. Now we are doing the same because mass media is not free in Belarus.
It is not free.
But we are a convenient spot on the map. Sitkunai or other site.
Mauritania.
It is conveniently located
for radio broadcasting
to Russia and to Belarus. So we will continue our mission.
Your mission started 18 years ago in the year 2000.
Were there any
reactions from the Russian or Belarusian sites
to your broadcast?
Did you ever experience problems?
No, there were no problems, but there were some comments in the Belarusian state-controlled media, state-controlled press. At the beginning, in the year 2000, maybe 2001, when we started broadcasting the Belarus service of Radio Liberty, many hours a day. But these were only small comments, and that's it, so nothing.
Radio Baltic Waves is, in fact, a radio station that puts content from Belarus sources into separate radio channel to a brand new one.
Yes, we have a license to put programming, to put content on the medium wave frequency 13862.
So we have a license.
And we lease the transmitting equipment from the state-owned transmitting center. Part of this transmitting center is the station Sitkunai, and the new site, which is also owned by the state-owned company.
As many of private broadcasters in the same way.
I mean the FM radio stations and TV stations.
Typically, not all, but typically they lease the transmitters from
this transmitting center, which has more than 30, maybe 35 or 40 sites across Lithuania.
So yes, we put a programming into this 13864.
At the beginning, in 2000 and 2001, we produced our own daily programming in Belarusian language, up to 4 hours a day. But since 2002, we only compose our program from content provided by such broadcasters like Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, Polish Radio, Radio Japan, and other stations.
So, if you want to hear a good sound of an old Soviet transmitter that's more than 50, 60 years old, tune into 13864. Some days left here from Sitkunai.
And with these impressions, finish our program. Bye bye, Sitkunai.
Thanks to Rimantas ladies who made this possible. Who told much about the radio history in Lithuania, and Audrius Matonis from Radio News. My name is Christopher Milling, thanks for tuning in, and goodbye.
Our broadcast to Australia and New Zealand. You can hear the repetition of this program tonight at 22 to 23 UTC. Transmitters of WRMI beam to North America on 5950 kHz. Tomorrow we will be on air from 12 to 13 UTC on the very same frequency as today, 9875 kHz beam to Eastern Asia and Japan. From 16 to 17 UTC, we had a transmitter of Spaceline in Bulgaria on 9400 kHz, beamed to Western Europe. From 18 to 19 UTC, beamed to North Europe and the Baltics on 7465 kHz via Armenia. From 21:30 to 22:30, we are WRMI on 9955 kHz, beamed to Central America. And repetition on Monday, the 17th of April, from 1 to 2 UTC on 9395 kHz, beamed to Northern Eastern America, also via the transmitters of WRMI.
If you want to write to us, please feel free. Our email address is info@shortwaveservice.com. Once more, info@shortwaveservice.com. Thanks for tuning in and goodbye.